years of song festivals. And he made the Estonians sing songs in Russian, and he made them sing songs that glorified Lenin and glorified Stalin and glorified Marx, but the Estonians snuck one by. A man named Gustav Ernesaks took a 100-year-old poem that was a famous nationalist poem in Estonia, written by Lydia Koidula, essentially Estonia's national poetess. And he put that poem to music. Well, it slipped by the Soviet censors because they had no idea about Estonian history. They had no idea the true meaning of this poem. But every Estonian who sung this song knew exactly what it meant. They knew this is a traditional song from my youth that is all about how I love my land and I love Estonia. And they proudly sang that song in Estonian, one of the few songs in Estonian they were allowed to sing in 1947. And Stalin had no idea what he was up against. That song became the unofficial national anthem in Estonia. And for the next 50 years, they always sang at the close of the song festivals. The interesting twist to me is, it was newly written rock songs in the 1980s that coalesced the movement, that brought everyone together. They didn't decide to rely upon this centuries-old traditional music. They're new young people to write new music. So a man named Alo Matizin in particular wrote five particular songs that were very meaningful about Estonian independence. And part of how the singing revolution got started, and of course it's a fuzzy beginning, it didn't happen overnight, but a key event happened in June of 1988. There was a rock concert with Alo Matizin, with Alo Matizin's band, and Ivo Lina, who was another leader of the band. They were singing these songs, and I don't know how many tens of thousands of youth were there singing into the night. And the Soviet authorities got worried, and they shut down the concert. They said, you can't sing anymore, enough's enough. And the people walked 3 miles to an open field to continue singing. And they sang until 5 or 6 in the morning. Now, Estonia is a very north latitude, and this was known as the White Nights. This is June. So in June, you have maybe 1 hour of darkness. So they would sing to 5 or 6 in the morning in that kind of daylight you have in the northern hemispheres, in the far northern hemispheres. And it went on for a week, and every night more and more people came until there were maybe 100, 150,000 people singing these Alo Matizin and rock and roll songs, as well as some traditional songs. The Soviet police saw this, but they didn't know what to do, because part of what happened in the Soviet Union was Gorbachev, on the one hand, was declaring glasnost and perestroika and more freedom. On the other hand, you had these old-line bureaucrats, these Soviet bureaucrats running the system. It's not like Gorbachev could reappoint all his bureaucrats overnight, and these people didn't know what to do. They were used to sort of the Brezhnev way of doing things, which would have been arrest some people, throw them in jail, hit a few heads, but under Gorbachev, maybe we don't do this. So part of what happened were the Soviet authorities locally were confused as to what to do, so they let it go on. And the Estonians just kept on pushing that envelope until eventually they contributed significantly to the collapse of the Soviet Union.